Earth is a solar-powered planet. At the bottom of the food chain, plants use photosynthesis to convert sunlight into chemical energy, food for the rest of us.
I like eating both grass, essentially wheat, and I also fancy the odd hamburger from a cow that has eaten that grass. So this whole ecosystem is powered by sunshine.
But recent studies have shed new light on how life developed under our sun. Specifically, the role of ultraviolet light.
UV radiation is useful for breaking molecules up and triggering reactions. Maybe that played a role in the origin of life.
It breaks down simple organic molecules, and then they can rebuild themselves into things that are more complex. If you do that over and over again, eventually you somehow get life.
Scientists think life on Earth started around 4 billion years ago, a time when Earth's atmosphere gave little protection. UV radiation levels were 100 times higher. Was UV essential for the development of life's code, DNA?
We know that life on Earth stores information in DNA and then uses that information to build proteins. So we have the blueprints and the bricks. The blueprints are the DNA and the bricks are the proteins.
But we think that the first life on Earth, we used a chemical which is much simpler.
This simpler chemical was RNA, DNA's single-stranded forefather.
RNA is almost like a two-for-one offer. It does both of the fundamental things you need for a cell in the same compound.
So it was simultaneously the bricks and the blueprint.
Unlike other molecules, RNA is more resistant to the high UV environment of early Earth, allowing it to flourish. RNA eventually evolved into DNA, and life started.
To have life on the planet, one important consideration is a certain amount of light that's gonna be needed, and a certain type of light that's gonna be needed.
So if all stars emit some UV radiation, can life start around any star?
When we think about looking for places that are conducive for life, we want to find a planet that might have enough UV radiation, so the star is you know, bright enough or close enough that it's providing enough energy to the surface for life, but we also don't want to have too much UV radiation.
It seems you need just the right amounts of UV. The most common stars in the galaxy are red dwarf stars.
If red dwarf stars can harbor life on planets around them, there's an awful lot of real estate like that in our galaxy.
Red dwarf stars could be good for life's chance of conquering the universe in a number of ways.
One, they represent over 3/4 of all stars in the universe. Two, they live for over 1,000 times longer than sun-like stars. And three, they seem to have rocky planets around them much more often than sun-like stars do.
Those are the pros, but red dwarf stars also have cons. For instance, they might not be bright enough for life to begin.
Some of the red dwarf stars that we know emit less ultraviolet light than the sun.
They don't give off much UV light at all. Maybe on a planet around them, there isn't enough energy to get life started.
Red dwarf stars are also much more temperamental. They can go from being gentle and quiet to having violent outbursts, stellar flares.
These types of stars have incredibly strong flares. That means they're shooting off a bunch of energetic particles and radiation and light that's baking the surface of those planets.
If the star is just bombarding the surface with UV, then it will destroy all of those things necessary for life. It will actually destroy the life itself.
These stellar flares could strip away a planet's atmosphere, sterilizing the surface. More research is needed, but for now, the odds of life thriving around dwarf stars are a toss-up. So far, the only thing we know is that there is one kind of star that's definitely right for life. Our sun.
We know of life in one place in the universe, and that's here, that's Earth.
Only 4% of stars in the universe are like our sun. So, if life can only get started around these rare, medium-sized stars, the chances are not looking good. But life may have an ace up its sleeve. What if life can start on just one planet and then spread? What if life travels across the cosmos looking for planets to conquer? Earth is our only example of life emerging anywhere in the universe. But what if life on Earth didn't start on Earth at all?
There's one idea that life on Earth actually didn't get going here, but was delivered from space.
Scientists call this theory panspermia.
The idea of panspermia essentially talks about the transfer of life throughout the cosmos.
We know asteroids and comets carry organic molecules. But could they carry life itself?
What if life starts on one planet? Can it actually get itself to a nearby planet? Is it possible that meteorites could actually transport living beings?
For life to travel around the cosmos, first it needs to take flight. An asteroid is on a collision course with an inhabited planet.
So what happens if there's a huge cataclysmic collision on a planet? Material is blasted off into space.
The impact might kill life on the surface of that planet. But it's possible some bacteria might escape, hitching a ride on chunks of the planet's surface.
A meteorite being ejected from a planet after an asteroid impact, I mean, that's not going to be an easy ride. But it turns out it's not as bad as you think.
Some bacteria are very, very hard to kill. Some we even don't know how to kill. Even the impact that actually threw that rock into space, for bacteria, no problem.
If those chunks of rock expelled during asteroid collisions could actually hold on to viable organisms, then it really could change the way in which we think about life spreading in the universe.
If the microbes can survive takeoff, then they can start their journey to a new home. The odds of life conquering the universe seem to be getting better.
The important question now is, how long could that life, those bacteria, those microorganisms inside that rock, survive the space environment?
Exposure to UV radiation could be fatal, killing any life on the surface of an asteroid. But experts think that microbial passengers could still survive by hiding underground.
It doesn't take much to shield a microorganism from UV. Just a little bit of rock and you have enough protection to just hold on throughout a journey to the next body, to your next home.